Here you can see a very popular graph that shows the world record efficiencies for various photovoltaic technologies over the years. The record efficiency shows for every different PV technology the best performance of processed solar cells under lab conditions. The efficiency of some PV technologies have only steadily increased, whereas others have made a more rapid jump in record efficiencies. You have to realize that comparing different PV technologies is more or less comparing apples and oranges. Like, do these record solar cells have, for instance, the same size? No, that is not the case. Some of these record devices have sizes of only 1 square centimeter. Therefore, it is important to realize how these solar cells and technologies scale up. So let's scale it up. Now the overview becomes different. In this graph, you can see the area of the solar cell or module on the horizontal axis and the record efficiencies on the vertical axis. You can also see in what range the area of a lab cell lies, as well as the area for a wafer or even a module. Here, it can be clearly seen that when technologies are scaled up, the efficiency mostly goes down. So on a typical module size ranging from 5,000 up to 15,000 square centimeters, the conversion efficiencies are different compared to the NREL graph. Another aspect what needs to be addressed is the reliability of the PV technology. For applications in an outside environment, the performance of a solar cell module should stay stable for at least 25 years. The efficiencies of the PV technology shown in orange are not stable efficiencies and therefore are expected to significantly drop in time. Now, let's take a look at the main PV technologies. They are categorized in first, second and third generation PV technologies. The first generation technology are based on crystalline silicon. Second generation are so-called thin film technologies, and the third generation technology consists of new device concepts that can exceed the theoretical efficiencies of conventional cells of the first and second generation. The third generation technology capable of doing that are, for instance, high efficiency multi-junction devices with record efficiencies up to 46%. Let's start with the most common PV technology, crystalline silicon-based solar cells. We can make a distinction between two types of silicon wafers, monocrystalline silicon and multicrystalline silicon. Monocrystalline, or also called single crystalline, is a solid in which the crystal lattice is continuously without grain boundaries over the entire material, up to the edges of the ingot. It's a single crystal. In contrast, multicrystalline silicon, also sometimes called polycrystalline silicon, is a material that consists of many small crystalline grains with random orientations. Between the grains, multicrystalline silicon has logically grain boundaries. Here you see two pictures of monocrystalline silicon and multicrystalline wafers. The monocrystalline silicon wafer has one uniform color, whereas in multicrystalline silicon, the various grains are clearly visible to the human eye. At the grain boundaries, we find lattice mismatches. As a result, many defects reside at the grain boundaries. Consequently, the lifetime of charge carriers in multicrystalline silicon is shorter than for monocrystalline silicon due to higher defect recombination. Also, the resulting efficiency of the solar cell will be smaller for multicrystalline silicon. Mono or multicrystalline silicon can be used to manufacture a typical solar cell as we have seen before. A back and front contact sandwiching a p-n junction created by a p and n type silicon zones in the silicon wafer. This silicon wafer can either be mono or multicrystalline silicon. The silicon wafer based p-n junction has a thickness of about 200 micrometer. This is about twice the thickness of a human hair. The silicon-based solar cell is the most established technology, which means it has matured and has become a relatively cheap technology due to upscaling. Current industrial processes are well streamlined and efficient. The increase of the use of this type of PV technology has made it very affordable. Current record efficiency monocrystalline silicon-based solar cells are 25.6% and on module level already have reached 24%. Let's take a look at PV technology record holders. One of the techniques that is enabled extremely high efficiency is called multi-junction technology. This is obtained by stacking multiple PN junctions on top of each other. Each of these layers absorbs a slightly different part of the solar spectrum. Of course, this is not as simple as it sounds, but it is possible. The record multi-junction solar cells are made using the so-called 3-5 technology. The term 3-5 refers to the groups in the periodic table from which the layers are made. The elements of the 3 group have 3 valence electrons, whereas the ones from the 5 group, yes, you guessed it, have 5 valence electrons. One of the most common examples of such a material is gallium arsenide. Gallium is not as abundantly available as silicon and is therefore more expensive. In addition, the manufacturing process of these solar cells is very costly. This makes a 3-5 solar cell very expensive in reference to silicon PV technology. As the 3-5 PV technologies are expensive, they are used for space applications and in concentrated technology. In these applications, the high performance is the number one priority. The dollar per watt peak of a small expensive 3-5 multi-junction device can be improved by concentrating the irradiance of a large area on the small solar cell device. One of the advantages of concentrating sunlight is that the open circuit voltage is increased with the irradiance as long as the solar cell is not significantly heated up. Let's now take a look at some other thin film solar technologies. The main 3 thin film PV technologies are the cadmium telluride PV technology, the CIGS PV technology, CIGS stands for copper indium gallium selenide sulfide, and thin film silicon technology. Thin film glass modules like these are mainly based on cadmium telluride and CIGS technologies due to their relatively high module conversion efficiencies from 14 up to 18%. The main advantage of the thin film absorber layers is that they can also be deposited on flexible substrates, unlike crystalline silicon. Here you see 3 examples for the cadmium telluride, CIGS, and thin film silicon PV technology. The thickness of a thin film solar cell lies around 2 to 5 micrometers compared to the 200 microns of a normal crystalline silicon solar cell. The combination of flexibility and lightweight offers a much wider range of applications compared to the conventional glass encapsulated modules. Organic solar cells like polymer cells or dye-sensitized solar cells are a relatively new technology. The materials used are conductive organic polymers or organic molecules. All these materials can be considered as large conjugated systems. The organic polymers and molecules consist of a large compounds based on carbon. The carbon may form a cyclic or acyclic linear or mixed compound of structures. Although the organic absorber material can be very cheap, the required encapsulation to protect the in nature not very stable material from ambient air is very expensive. The stability issues limit the large-scale industrial application for the moment of these technologies. The current record efficiency of an organic triple junction solar cell on lab scale lies around 13%. The final technology we will discuss are perovskite solar cells. The technology uses mineral as an absorber layer with the general formula of ABX3. Where X is an anion and both A and B are cations. This technology has been rapidly developed in the last decade with huge increase in efficiencies. The first reported efficiencies in 2006 were around 2%, whereas currently they can reach as high as 22% on lab scale. The biggest hurdle to face for this technology is that it cannot yet be applied industrially. The solar cells still suffer from many instabilities due to moisture, biasing, and light conditions. Enough on PV technologies. Let's make a PV system. In the next lectures, we are going to talk in more detail on the component of the entire PV system. So see you in the next block.